Hello and welcome to the first video with It's Dr. Dan. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be learning all about chemistry. And why exactly are we here? What is the point of taking a chemistry class other than, oh, I got to do it as a prerequisite? Well, chemistry is one of those courses that helps to bring together essentially everything that you're learning in college. Whether it's biology or learning about health science courses, it helps us be able to describe the world around you. It helps you be able to observe things, right? If you want to be a healthcare provider and you are taking care of a patient, you are making observations about their health conditions. You're writing down numbers. You are taking note of how their pain levels. You are writing a lot of things down so that doctors and the team members in the hospital know how to save an individual. If you are someone that's maybe working in, let's say, the agricultural industry, and you want to get the highest possible crop yield, you're going to be possibly measuring soil pHs, looking at how the trees and the different groves are behaving. You need to take measurements, need to actually observe those different changes. They are all around us as we are looking at these different things. Now, when we are trying to understand the whole idea of measurement and observation, there is a lot that can realistically go into this. It can be really, really complicated. And it can get a little scary, too, along the way. So let's go into it. Let's try to figure out exactly what is chemistry. Why are we trying to torture ourselves with this class? What are we trying to learn along the way? Now, when it comes to chemistry, the first thing is understanding, well, what is it? What exactly are we doing, right? We always say like, oh, they have chemistry. Well, what does that mean? Well, chemistry has been defined for ages now. But one of the things that definition behind it has always kind of been redefined. But there's always been one single constant that's always existed, and that is change. There's always change. And that is what chemistry is all about, is trying to figure out, well, what exactly is changing? So if I were to just look at, let's say, this car that I have here on the slide, and I were to ask you, well, what can you observe about this car? Well, you can say like, well, it's a really nice car. It's a sports car. It's red. It's very nice metal. But if you let this thing, let's say it sits outside for 30 years, 40 years, and all the elements and raining conditions near maybe a coastline where there's salt in the air, what could happen to it? Well, it could turn into this, right? It could turn into an old rust bucket. Now, it's still a sports car. It's still Mustang. It still can do probably 0 to 60 with a lot of love and support, but it does not look the same. There has been change that has occurred here. Well, how can you define that change? What can you say about it? Well, before, right, we could say the car was really red. It was very shiny. Now it's kind of like brown. It's orange. There's like some white part or tints here. It's all falling apart. You know, it's not completely the car that you knew about before. So when we are talking about chemistry, what we're trying to see is here is that it allows us to really understand how and why matter is changing. Now, what is matter? What is the matter? Matter is essentially anything that has a mass and it has a volume, and it's something that exists around you, right? Everything around you is matter, whether it's maybe, let's say, like my notes, or maybe like my coffee cup, or this pencil I'm just grabbing things around me, right? All these things are made of matter. Now, what we're trying to do is figure out is how and why can they possibly change? And it's all around you. This is one of the reasons why this is such an important course, because it's an everyday life, right? We see it everywhere. Now, when it comes to like some examples, really, and I'll be showing these examples again later in the semester, is that you can see it everywhere, whether it's, let's say, the trees around you trying to give you oxygen in order to live and to exist. Photosynthesis is taking the CO2 out of the air and creating energy for itself, and it's creating natural sugars in the process in order to live. It also makes O2, which is necessary for us to live. if you're someone that loves to eat, right? We all eat every single day. That digestion process is hundreds of reactions that are occurring one after another with enzymes and different metabolic pathways to help us really be able to see how can your body break something down, right? If you eat this giant, let's say, piece of bread or this big steak, right? You're breaking down your teeth, but that's only the beginning. It has to go through the entire digestive tract, right? So if you're taking chemistry, eventually you'll take anatomy and physiology as well. And this is the foundation to understanding that process. For a lot of us as well, right? If we just went through a pandemic and we had you still should. You're told to wash your hands and wear masks and do all these things. Washing your hands, putting soap on your hands will destroy bacterial cell walls. So that way they can't easily reproduce, right? So it's something that helps stop that process. If you're over the age of 21 and you like beer and wine, right? That is chemistry, right? Yeast is making alcohol and is something that is enjoyed by millions of people around the world. Same thing if you're a baker or a cooker, right? If you do any of those things, or chef, not cooker, and you do any of those things, all those are chemical reactions. It's everywhere, right? You probably have made something in the past 48 hours, right, in your kitchen. That was chemistry. You are already on your first steps. If you are currently looking at your cell phone or your laptop just to watch this video or your phone, the battery's in it, the screen that you have, think of what is an LED, right? That is a light emitting diode, which is essentially made of different chemicals that are all different that are in different combinations to help you see me right now. Same with your batteries, right? That charge is electrons being transferred. They're everywhere. So when it comes to matter, we are observing these things. It takes up many different forms, as I said. So what are some of those forms? Well, let's look at what can you see? What do you observe? How can you measure it? Ask those questions for yourself, especially as you're going through lab. You want to be able to see what is it that you are looking at here. So if I look at the first one, right, you can see this pot of water here. It's boiling, right? We can see the fire that's hot. But what exactly are we seeing on the atomic scale, right? We want to start thinking small, right? Chemistry is all about the atoms. And that's what we're going to be talking about in the future. So if you kind of zoom in on that water, and let's say if I want to look at the really tiny picture of that, well, these are made of water molecules, right? Little atoms that are all bound together. If I look at a balloon and I look at the one next to it, right, you can see that this is a helium atoms that are inside of it. They're so far apart that it's caught, and they're so light and not dense at all that it's causing the balloon to float, right? It's made of different atoms that have different compositions. So when it comes to matter, there's different properties behind all of them, right? If you think of water, you can drink it. It has a certain maybe kind of taste to it. It's a liquid at a room temperature. If it gets cold enough, it turns into a solid. If it gets too hot, it turns into steam. It's made of all these things called particles, right? So particles are anything that's a really tiny atomic microscopic particle, and this is what makes up all of matter. They're all organized in a very specific way to make up all these things. Now, so this is what matter is composed of. And we're going to be referring to a lot of the chemistry that we're going to look at in the next few weeks or on this channel is from the particle standpoint, right? So how exactly can we understand that? Now, when it comes to these different particles, how exactly are they organized? Well, it's all from the periodic table, which I like to refer to it as the chemist alphabet, right? When you first learn how to read and write, you learn the alphabet. You learned how all these different orders of letters can produce all kinds of interesting combinations of words that you speak on a regular basis, or you text on a regular basis, or you send in a DM on a regular basis. It's the same idea. You have this alphabet here that you're trying to understand. And one of the things about it is, you want to start kind of memorizing it, especially if you're going to be taking a chemistry course, taking a lot of science courses. This table is going to be referred to a lot. And the big reason why is it so referred to is being that, like I said, matter has properties, and this table organizes all of the properties within it. So it helps us be able to understand that basic idea of, okay, there's properties. Now, how is that organized? Well, if you look at the columns and then look at the first one, these are called the alkali metals. And I recommend knowing the names of the major areas. these are very reactive. Essentially, if you throw any of these in water, they will immediately explode. Let's try to take a look at how that would work. Okay, so one thing that you'll notice, the alkali metals are very, very reactive. So this one's lithium. And as you can see, this professor is adding it to water. You can see it's bubbling. It's releasing hydrogen gas. They added an indicator that changes the water color. So it's showing how it's going to produce an acid. This is sodium. So going down those periodic tables, this one's even more reactive. You see it bubbling even more and more and more. And then you're going to see it explodes, how much it actually will show from this. And going down to potassium, so it's lithium, sodium, now potassium. This is going to be more reactive. It instantly catches on fire. It starts sparking, exploding. You can see how reactive these chemicals are. And as they are reacting, they get even more and more violent. And if you kept going down the periodic table, you'll see it like it's even crazier. So this is potassium in slow motion. And you can see how it's sparking. It's exploding. It's very, very violent. And this is being done in a classroom at a university. So that was really cool to see, right? Alkali metals are very, very reactive, taking a little bit from some other people, right? They are reactive. Now, if you look at alkaline earth metals, this is what we see in fireworks and displays and all the different colors that we can see as well. As you can see, all the different properties that are here are all extremely different, right? And they're right next to each other in the periodic table. Every single element has its own unique properties. Now, when it comes to the other ones, which are the nictogens, the chalcogens, and the halogens, a little bit of a tongue twister, you don't have to be perfect in knowing those first two there. But the halogens, you should know, these are all very, very different gases, right? The ones on the left, all metals, they're all solids, they're all have different properties. So alkali metals were very reactive, alkaline, not so reactive unless you put a flame to it. The other ones are all gases. A lot of them are found within our atmosphere. Then eventually the halogens are super reactive. And the last one is the noble gases. These are always, I always say, are dignified and above the rest, and they don't quite interact as much, right? We have all these different things. They're organized. They all have different properties. That's the important thing. So now that we realize that, how this is one thing that we need to make sure we start to understand and to start memorizing as we move forward. Because we need to be able to observe the universe around us, we need to be able to understand it. So start memorizing it. But the thing is, depending on your chem class, in my course, you don't have to memorize the whole thing. I tell everybody the first 20 elements is a good starting point. You want to be able to essentially memorize the symbols and then their names. Put them on flashcards. Help you remember them because they are the common ones. The first 20, a lot of them are the essential minerals that are found within the human body to help keep us alive. If you're a health scientist, you will commonly refer to a lot of them. Let's say, for example, potassium, K. A lot of times some people are potassium deficient and you need to be able to tell them that. So, right, it's going to be written by the letter K to represent that. Calcium is one of the things that you, if you drink milk, you use calcium to make strong bones, as I say. It's a very important mineral within the body. So a lot of these are common, right? You see them all around you. So memorize the first 20, put them on flashcards, and start learning. This has been Dr. Dan, and I'll see you in the next video. Thank you so much for stopping by, and I'll see you all later. Bye now.